Trinity.
Amen.
Okay, we're here today on the third session of the School of Crossfire Evangelism. And today we talk about the altar, the cross, and the fire. And this is going to be very, very good because God wants to take us deeper. He wants us to understand how to get the fire, but in a way that really will transform us. I'm going to read first from the Word of God, and that is 1 Corinthians. Father, I pray you use the Word that will burn in everybody's heart and will challenge them and transform them and break them further, deeper. And Father, that they learn to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
So, the last time I talked in chapter 2, I talked about brokenness at the cross of Christ. It says in Psalm 51 that the sacrifices of God are a broken and a contrite heart. And that is what God wants. And it says in Psalm 51 also that God wants to bring truth in the hidden man. What has happened today with many churches, they have focused on the outside. They're excited, they make people excited. We can jump, we can have light shows or whatever. But what happens is they're not being transformed on the inside. God wants the real believers to be transformed on the inside. So a lot of Christians have learned to live in the soul. But a true Christian is not called to live in the soul, it's called to live in the
spirit.
So if we focus on the outside, outside Christianity, we never learn to walk in the spirit. And how do we get in the spirit is by the working of the cross of Jesus Christ. And it's about brokenness at the cross of Jesus Christ. That's where we're going to be transformed. And so, I'm going to read the word again. So, 1 Corinthians 2. And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellent of speech or wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Everybody say, crucified.
Crucified.
And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power.
Whoa.
That your faith should not stand in wisdom of man, but in the power of God. Now, Amy and me, when we were in the Netherlands, we were part of a ministry called Spirit and Power. We were gospel singers, Amy and me, and we went through the Netherlands, we went to Belgium, and we would sing songs. And the ministry was a good ministry, but what happened, they focused on spirit and power. And that's good. We need spirit and power. But now God has showed me, Nicholas, it doesn't start there. It doesn't. It starts by the cross of Jesus Christ. Mm. And see what has happened now with the body of Christ. People only think about the cross when it's Easter or Passover, or when they do a salvation message. But the body of Christ today doesn't understand about coming daily at the cross of Christ. This is something that has been pushed away. And therefore, God has not been able to move in greater power. Because when we talk about spirit and power, and we use the gifts, But we don't move deeper to the cross. We start to use the soul to produce God's move. And that's wrong. And so because God wants to take us further in what? Into the fullness. The fullness comes when our lives is sacrificed at the cross of Christ. See, we can work with gifts and then with charisma and pull a crowd, but we won't see the revivals of old. The revivals of old will only come by tarrying at the cross of Christ on a daily basis. Why? Because others, what happens is this. We do some preaching and we use the gifts, but partly we will be moving from the flesh. Partly we're moving from the soul. And this is what has been happening. And we make the people all excited about a new car, a new house, a new this and that. It's all outside. You see that? And so Jesus said about the Pharisees, you make the cup clean on the outside, but you forget the inside. See, Jesus wants the inside to be changed. Why? Because that's where the fruits of the Spirit grow. The fruits of the Spirit don't grow in a nice car, a nice house. No, it is in the Spirit. It is with you having a deep life with Jesus. And this is why Apostle Paul said this. I do not know anything else but Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And it is not just for a salvation message. And because that is what we've been taught. It's all about the salvation message when we preach that. But no, Apostle Paul, when we read the book of Philippians, he talks about how he wants being in a deeper relationship with God. And he said, not that I have yet gotten there. That is what Apostle Paul said while God used him in a mighty way. He said, not that I've gotten there yet. Yeah? So what is he saying? I want to die. I want to know his death so I might be part of his resurrection. So what he is saying, that the real truth of the power of God lies in what? In dying. Dying to self. And that's not just when you're born again. That is on a daily basis, learning to die. That is why the first church had daily communion. Daily communion. Why? When we talk about communion, we talk about the cross. When we talk about the cross, we talk about communion. And so the church, the first church, moved in great power. Why? Because they daily celebrated the death of Christ. Daily they were changed. Why? Because they pressed into the cross of Christ. You see, this is what Apostle Paul said. He said, I do not know anything else but Jesus Christ and I'm crucified. He wanted to go in a deep, deep fellowship of his suffering. Today, a lot of ministries, they don't believe in suffering. When I was just saved in Hawaii, or filled with the Holy Spirit, gave my whole life, very soon I was doing evangelism on the street, and they broke my nose. Yeah, they broke my nose. You see, so if I didn't believe, you know, in hard times, I would have quit. You see, I was beaten twice in Hawaii. Yeah, for Jesus. You see, and it's not easy. And they, in the Bible, they did a better job than me. But still, I kept going. Because Apostle Paul said that I might know him and the sufferings of him. Why? Because in the sufferings of Jesus, you get a burden for the lost souls. Yes. You feel what God is feeling. You know, I did this thing on the COVID-19 here. God, I had an encounter like into heaven. And a friend came and I said, let's do right now this thing on the Facebook. And I felt the heart of God. How God was weeping over all the abortions. God was weeping and he showed me how these demons were taking people out now because they had gotten free range because of the sin of men. But I was weeping. Why? Because I felt the heart of God. I felt the heartbeat of heaven about all the babies that were killed. You see? And I said, it's because of the sin. The sin of man, that this can happen. So man has opened the door for the devil to start to take control. So now the only way to stop it is 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people are called by my name who and humble themselves and pray, I will hear from heaven. And this is how things will change. And I believe next week, Saturday, there's prayer meetings in Australia, in many places, in America, to pray this prayer in repentance. And so that is how things will only shift by our prayer. Where? At the cross of Christ. Amen. So now I'm going to read to you another scripture about the cross. And it is 1 Corinthians 1:18-17. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with words of wisdom, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Yeah, so the first part of this preaching is this. Many people believe that the power of God comes through the Holy Spirit. And yes, the power comes through the Holy Spirit, but it doesn't start there. It starts by this. We need to get a revelation of this scripture. It says, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. What is the power of God? The preaching of the cross. The preaching of the cross is the power of God for those who are saved. So if you want to grow in the power of God, you need a deeper revelation of the cross of Christ on a daily basis. Mm. Yes, we need to learn to do communion every day. Mm. I start to do it more, but I'm not there yet because God is doing a work in my heart, and I want to be in a deep place with God. And so I'm trying to press in to start to do more communion, because He wants to change us. And the only way is to the working of the cross of Christ on a daily basis. But see, we have been taught, because many of us come from a Pentecost background or a charismatic background, so we are taught that all the power comes through the Holy Spirit, but we have not understood the power of the cross. And so I made a new slogan, and the slogan is this: as deep as the cross goes, that is how deep the power of the Holy Spirit will flow. I will say it again: as deep as the cross goes, that is how deep the fire of the Holy Ghost will flow. Yes. And we need to start to get that. See, for the last days church, the only way to survive is to have a deep relationship with Christ and the cross of Christ. Why? Because that is where we see the suffering that He went through, how much He loves us, how much now He's interceding for us, and how much He's suffering with the saints who are suffering in nations, who are being persecuted. And that is the heart of God. And if you come in that is where you will get the strength to keep going when it's really hard. But what has happened? Many people have made the cross void of His power. How has that happened? By words of wisdom of men. The words of the wisdom of men, of humanism, of hermeneutics. They have shut up the keys of the kingdom. Because people talk like it comes from brain power. But it doesn't come from brain power. It's spirit power. Yes, and so it's Spirit teaching Spirit. Holy Spirit teaching your spirit. It's not a brain academy. Many pastors have gone to brain academy, but they didn't learn prayer academy, worship, and being in the spirit academy. No, they are taught by the Greek mindset, which is under Hermes. Hermeneutics is under Hermes. Yeah, so that is a Greek god, and we have to break that over our lives, the Greek gods, because it stops us from what? To live in the Spirit. Yeah, on the last lesson I was teaching how it says that the Spirit teaches the spirit man. And that is where we have to come to learn to be taught by God. Not with our mind, in our spirit. And it's our spirit that renews our mind. It's the Holy Ghost that renews our mind. It doesn't go from our mind to our spirit, but from our spirit to our mind. Why? Because God is spirit. And those who come to him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. So true evangelism lies in preaching about the power of the cross, about daily being at the cross. And this is what we need to learn. So the question is, do you understand that? So the thing is, many of us, we think we know, we think we understand, but we don't press in at the cross the way the Bible shows us, because we don't understand it. It's a battle of understanding it. And we will see it in the scripture in a minute. Now, let me tell you, in 2010, me and Amy and family, we went to the Solomon Islands to preach. We went to different denominations. And we were first by the Pentecostal Assemblies of God. And I thought, wow, God is going to move so mightily because they're very hungry. So I preached, and the Lord has said to me, see, I've been in India. We talk about 10 years ago. And God had used me. A whole place was shaken by God. Souls were saved. People were baptized. It was amazing. Amazing things happened. And then I came back to Australia. And the Lord said, you talked about the Holy Spirit, but I want you to know more about the cross. And if you know much more about the cross, you're going to see many more salvations. So then I started to do that. Searching out about the cross in the Word of God. But all hell broke loose against us. All hell, like, we were here, those people up, because our road goes up, and once they knocked on our door, and they said, I said, yeah, hello. They said, yeah, our car just rolled down and just hit your car. So Amy's car was totaled. And, you know, just rolled down. You see, crazy things happened. Yeah. Yeah, why? Because God wanted me to understand the message of the cross in a deep way. And so we've been pressing in. So here we go to the Solomon Islands. I made a book called The Gospel of the Cross. And we have printed them out with 20 cases of books with us. And so I'm excited. I'm at the Pentecostal church. I start to preach about the cross and this and that. And God only moves a little bit. They couldn't get it. Because they thought they had it. They had the Holy Spirit. That is what they were thinking. We have the Holy Spirit. Yeah? Because we are Pentecostal or we are charismatic. So we have it. So we cannot really learn much more because we have arrived. Yeah? Isn't what people think. They have arrived. So that was their mindset. So God just did little things. Then on the Sunday, we went to the South Sea Evangelical Church. And it was a bigger church. And I preached the message of the cross. And the people were so hungry. And they came to the front. And they received. And God's fire fell. And God's fire moved. And they were so hungry. And they wanted more. And they wanted to take the message to different places. Then this one man stood up. And he had been a leader of 500 churches. And he said, this is the real message. This is the real message. This is what we need. We need to go deep with this. You see? And so he understood. Because the evangelical church, they knew it's about the cross. It's the cross of Christ. You see? And so they got it. And that was good. But still God wants us to go deeper. Why? Because Jesus did not just move with the gifts, he moved in the fullness. And God wants to bring the last day church to the fullness. Okay, so the battle lies in understanding. So we're going to see what Jesus was saying to his disciples. So we're going to read this in Luke 24, verse 44. As you've looked that up, I'm going to quote the scripture. See, because Jesus did not just move in the nine gifts, he moved in the seven rivers of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And that's, we call that the fullness. And so Ephesians 1 verse 8, 17 and 18 says this, that the Father of glory may give unto you the spirit of wisdom, revelation and understanding, that you might know him more intimate. And then it says that you might know what the inheritance is in the saint and the mighty power that's available for them. And that is what it says there. Now, and so the battle there, here is in understanding. And so in that scripture, it talks about the spirit of understanding and revelation. And so now we're going to see what Jesus did here. So, and he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you, which I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets. And in the Psalms concerning me, concerning Jesus Christ. And then it said, then opened he their understanding, that they might understand these scriptures. You see that? The understanding went open. And to understand that you need to daily go to the cross, to have a deeper relationship with God, to be changed, transformed. Your understanding needs to be opened. Because then it says, thus it is written, and thus it behove Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. And that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. And behold, I will send the promise of my Father unto you. But tarry you in the city of Jerusalem, and you shall be endued with power from on high. So Jesus said, you didn't understand that I had to die on the cross. But he opened their understanding. That once they start to understand the message of the cross. And this is what the important thing is, to understand the message of the cross. Because if we want to move in the greater power of God, yes, we have the nine gifts, but Jesus walked in fullness. And he wants us to come and walk in fullness. And so there is much more for us to learn, much more for us to understand. But God doesn't give that unto people who are still walking in the flesh. So we have to learn to walk and die to self, to me, I and myself. We have to die to me, I and myself. And we do that on a daily basis at the cross. So that it's no longer that I live. You see, in many circles, I is living. Pride is rampant in many churches. Why? Because I is still living. I is still on the throne. Jesus hasn't become Lord. He is the Savior, but not the Lord. Because I is living, but Apostle Paul said in Galatians 2 verse 20, it's no longer I that liveth. Yeah? And this is the thing. So I was in New Zealand a few years ago. I was part of a revival school and did some other things. But there was a lot of mixture going on amongst the, especially the Maoris. And so they mixed tradition with Christianity. And so they let witchcraft, divination enter back into the churches. Mm-hmm. And it was all happening. They took all of us into the Moriah, where the idols were. and all these things, and they thought it was great. And so in those days, God showed me a vision, and He showed me this vision. He showed me the cross and the altar. He said, Nicholas, you need the cross and you need the altar. On the cross you have the blood, but on the altar you have the fire. You need blood and fire, Nicholas. Blood and fire. And so a lot of people only want a certain theme of God. And they take back old traditions, like Harry Potter in many Christian groups. It's becoming okay. But it's not. No. Because it's witchcraft. No. And the Bible forbids it. No. Simon the sorcerer. You know, just read the story. And then Bar Jesus, the one guy, he became blind. Yeah, because Apostle Paul was used by God. God brought judgment down on him. And so God said to me, you need the cross and you need the altar. And whenever you see in the old and the new an altar, you see the cross. And wherever the cross is in the new, you can see an altar. Yeah? Why? Because we need blood and fire. We need not only fire, we need blood and fire. Why? Because we need to be sanctified on a daily basis. You see, one of the lies in the body of Christ is that there's only positional sanctification. But the Bible really shows there's the three P's of sanctification. When you talk about Nicholas, I talk about positional, progressive, and perfection. That are the three P's. And so many Christians say, no, we only do the first one. Because we have arrived, everything is okay. And they walk like that. And therefore, this has become very, very, has invaded most of the churches now. And so people don't press into the cross anymore because they say, we have arrived. But Apostle Paul says, no, I haven't arrived. So who is then arrived? If Apostle Paul says, I have not arrived yet. I haven't gotten it yet. And the church says, we have gotten it. But the great miracles are not happening in the church. But by Apostle Paul, the great miracles were happening. And he said, I have not yet arrived. See, he wanted to go to the third P, perfection. John Wesley taught about perfection. Yeah, he knew about the three P's of sanctification. God used John Wesley in a mighty way. And so if we want to walk and see God move in a mighty way, we have to do it like the Bible says it, and like people like John Wesley who lived it out before us. He was a humble servant of God. So we have to learn to do what? To come back at the altar. Where does an altar talk about? Surrender. You want more of the fire of God, right? So you have to learn to come to the altar and to surrender. But you say, Nicholas, that is Old Testament. Then I say, how about Romans 12? Romans 12 is 1 and 2. Let's read it. So you see that we're right there in the New Testament. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is good, acceptable, perfect will of God. You see that? We are here to do what? To be a living sacrifice. A sacrifice is on the altar. There you have it. We are to give our life as a living sacrifice. So you, in the you're still on the earth, you're still breathing, right? Jill, are you still breathing?
Yeah, I hope so.
Okay. You hope so, that's good. So, see hope said. So what happens when we are not a living sacrifice anymore? We are not pressing into the fire of God. We need to be transformed, the Bible says. That is God's process. And that happens by surrendering to the work of the cross in your life. So, on Holy Communion, what did the Lord show us? He took the bread and he broke it. And he says, as often you come together, do this in my name. So where does the word broken body, what is it to speak about? That your life is going to be broken before the Lord. Mm-hmm. And then in the first church, they did the Holy Communion every day. So every day they were doing what? Breaking of the bread. Yeah? So that meant on a daily basis, they went to the cross of Christ. Yeah? Now Jesus has arisen. He is arisen. He is alive. He's not dead. He's alive. Amen?
Amen.
Yet it says, there is the message of the cross, there is the preaching of the cross, and there's the mystery of the cross. Yeah? And out of all of that we minister. There's the ministry of the cross. But the cross was a hidden mystery. That is why Jesus said, he opened their understanding, that they would start to understand the mystery. Apostle Paul says, I am an apostle sent to reveal to you the mysteries of the cross. But yes, there are still mysteries here today. And I saw one in 1 Corinthians 11, and it's about the Holy Communion. I won't go into it now, but it really made me wonder, because it says that we remember his death every time we have Holy Communion until he comes. So you can read that, and I won't go into it, but it's a mystery. It's a mystery that when you take Holy Communion, you're thinking about the death of Jesus Christ. Yet he is alive, but see, the blood is alive. And therefore he takes you to that zone, to that moment that he died for you. So that the blood is there for you today. It's fresh. It is new every morning. His blood is new every morning. We sing his love is new every morning, but so is his blood. So that daily you can be forgiven of your sins. Daily. So these are the mysteries. And so that makes the Holy Communion more like something mystical. Yeah? It's like, wow, Jesus, you died for me. And you're like, at that moment that he died for you. And I've heard accounts of people that have been taken to, in a vision, to Calvary, where they saw Jesus die. And it really transformed them. Yeah? It really transformed them. And so God wants us to go daily to the cross of Christ so we be changed. So what? So that you get an understanding of the power of the message of the cross. So you can do what I do. Preach the message of the cross. You need that understanding, like I do. I got an understanding. Why? I spent many hours, years, pressing in so that God would open my understanding in my mind, in my spirit, about the cross, that the power lies in the cross. So that you're going to go and be filled with more fire, because you are broken in a greater way. That God says, now there's more of me in them, so I can fill them more with my fire. And that is what God wants to do. That is what he wants to do with your life. And see, for some of you, this won't make sense yet. Why? Because you don't have that understanding. See, what I've learned is meditation on the Word of God brings revelation. And revelation brings impartation. An impartation brings demonstration. You see, so we need to meditate on the Word of God. Like, wow, God, I thought it's all about the power of the Holy Spirit. And here you shall be. Now, the message of the cross for those who believe is the power of God. God working me. I don't understand it. I need to get hold of it. See, and then as you do that, you get, as you meditate by day and by night on the Word of God, what it says. Lord, give me that understanding. Give me a revelation about that there's power in the cross. There's power in the blood. Today, I can be transformed more so that I surrender more so that you can work more through me. And so as you meditate, you get a revelation. And when you have a revelation, you say, wow, God, yeah, I surrender more. And then the Holy Spirit will start to give you an impartation of the power of the cross, the power of the blood. So what happens is authority starts working. You see, authority is going to work. See, many of us have, our quest was power. But the real quest is not power, it's authority. And so when you understand the power of the cross, the power of the blood, you're going to move in authority. Mm. Heavenly authority. Yeah? Mm. And we need authority. When you have that authority, you don't even have to move with power yet. The demons will start to tremble already. Mm. Because they know you're coming. Mm. You see? They knew Jesus was coming. Why? They knew his authority. You see? So this is what we need. We need to get that revelation about the power of the cross, the power of the blood. See, where was Satan defeated? The cross. And what it says, that the cross and the blood of the cross, Satan was defeated. And so where is he afraid of?
The blood.
The blood. The defeat of the cross. And if you have that revelation, you have that authority. Mm. You see? And that's where Jesus wants to take us, to have that authority of the cross in us. And then we don't need as much power as before, because your exousia, your authority is going to break through already. You speak softly and things happen. Mm. You see? And God has fullness. So he wants to move with fullness of power through us. But you need that breakthrough about that there is power in the preaching of the cross. There is power in daily coming at the cross to be changed. There is power and authority to daily have communion. And go in a deeper way in the Holy Communion. Amen. So, now Apostle Paul, so one group in the church focus on the cross, yet they don't believe in the moving of the Spirit. Yeah? And another group, like I said, they focus on the Holy Spirit, but not really on the cross. We need to do both. We need to focus on the working of the cross, let the cross work in us, but then be like Apostle Paul, who says that your faith will not stand in words of wisdom of men, but in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. And this is, see, I mean, that is so exciting. When you meditate on this, it becomes so alive in you that you know, wow, we are not to preach with wisdom of words. We are to preach the power of the blood of Jesus Christ, the power of the cross. And then the Holy Spirit will fill us and we will start to preach with power. Just open your Bible so this will sink in, you know. So it says in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 2, for I am determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And then in 4 it says, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of wisdom of men, but in demonstration, everybody says
demonstration.
Of the Spirit and power. Mm. Everybody says Spirit and power.
Spirit and power.
See, that's what I said. We do meditation, we get revelation, we get impartation, we go for demonstration.
Amen.
Hallelujah. This is what it says here, demonstration.
Mm.
We just read it. But in demonstration of the Spirit and power. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. That is where He wants us. That's where God wants you to walk in. Yeah? And so here we put both together. The altar, and the cross. Now I'm going to read now to you how in the Old Testament they were at the altar. This is King Solomon. And this is a very, very powerful story. 2 Chronicles 7, verse 1. So King Solomon was going to dedicate the temple, and he was praying. And they had slaughtered so many, many animals. And then they also made a big altar. And then on the altar there was many animals that were slaughtered. So there was blood. So there was the altar, there was blood, okay? And they were praying, and they was going to dedicate the temple to God. And then watch what happened. Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven. Everybody say fire.
Fire.
And consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. And the priest could not enter into the house of the Lord because of the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. You see that? So we had the blood, and then the fire came. Amen.
Amen.
Now, you might not be convinced yet, so we're going to go to the book of Acts. Acts 2. So Jesus Christ, He died on the cross for you and me. Yeah?
Mm.
Now, something happened on the day of Pentecost. And then Apostle Peter explained what had happened. So we're going to go to Acts 3, verse 31. It says, He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. The verse 33, this Jesus God had raised up, we are witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, He had sent for this, which you now see and hear. Jesus had given His blood.
That was Acts 2.
Acts 2. And so, Jesus had given His blood on the cross. Now, the Father said to Jesus, sit at my right hand. And then, the fire of the Holy Spirit was poured out. You see that? So this is Acts 2, and then one important scripture, 33. So the Holy Spirit was poured out by who? By Jesus. Because the Father said, you have fulfilled your mission, now I give to you the key that you, Jesus, pour it out. And so here we see what happened in the days of King Solomon. The fire came down because of the blood on the altar. Now we have the blood on the cross, yeah?
Mm.
And now the fire came down. Now, something amazing. See, people think that the ark is still lost from Israel. But if you watch Ryan White on the YouTube, you will see that the ark is right under Calvary.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing when you start to follow what he discovered, what God said, where the ark was, and he found it. It's a real supernatural story when you hear it. See, because the blood was not just only down on the earth, but the blood also went to heaven. Yeah, that's in the scripture. And so the ark was placed right under Calvary. And when the earthquake came, the blood went through the earth and onto the mercy seat. It's so supernatural. It's so amazing when you start to see it. And when you really get the revelation, you're going to be, wow. It you know, and see, the blood is alive. And they put this blood in the lab. And they said, where did you get that blood? Where did you get that blood? And the blood is still alive now. It's there, it's alive. And it just blows your mind when you see all of this. You see that, and that is why Jesus poured out the Holy Spirit. The fire came on the day of Pentecost. He gave his blood on the cross. And where the blood of the cross is, there is the fire of the Holy Spirit. You see that? So where there's an altar, there is a sacrifice. And when the sacrifice is there, there is fire. We see by Elijah, the fire came down. Amen. Mm. The fire came down. Mm. Why? Because the altar was made and he was called by God to defeat the false prophets. And the fire came down on the altar. Mm. And they said, Elijah's God is God. And that day was a move of God. Because the fire came on the altar. And so you are to be in the place of coming to the altar. See what has happened. Okay, there's this sister called Mary Kay Baxter, who was taken by the Lord 30 nights to hell. Mm. Now she has several books out. One is about the blood. Mm. One is about the blood of Jesus Christ. And the Lord said, I call you to be a warrior. Because what has happened, the Lord said, they've taken the altar out of the church. Mm. You see, they've taken the altar out of the church. So, what are we talking about? So now, in many churches, they've taken the crosses out of the church. So that's the next step, taking the crosses out of the church. So then many churches don't do salvation messages anymore. Yeah? Mm-hmm. So that is what is happening. It's all a setup. Mm-hmm. It's all a setup. Yeah? For one world religion. Mm-hmm. Yeah? But now we have the cross here. And wherever we go, at times we take the cross with us. Yeah? Because there is not a bloodless gospel. No. There's a good news that comes to us through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. And so you are to walk in the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. And daily have communion. And daily surrender yourself as a living sacrifice on the altar. Mm. Now, how does that work? In the meetings of Amy McPherson, when she was having meetings, people would be in the church and she would be preaching, and the Holy Spirit would move with conviction, would come with mighty conviction. Yeah? And people couldn't wait for her to finish. They would run to the front because they wanted to get saved. You see, that is the work of the altar in the front. The fire is on the altar. It's burning. It was burning in the house of God. And so then they could be led to Christ. And so this is why we need to have an altar. An altar where we talk about a place of prayer. My house is called what? A house of prayer for all the nations. You see that? So that is why we have the altar. So, and then at the altar we have the cross of Christ. So that we surrender ourselves to Christ in a deeper way. And then the blood washes us. Yeah? So we have to be a living sacrifice. The blood washes us, changes us. We ask, oh, Father, forgive me. I was so angry with my wife and I said bad words. Please forgive me. Father, I was jealous at that man. Father, forgive me. That's what we do at the altar on a daily basis, so that your marriage will blossom, so that children can grow up in a lovely home where a father says, please, son, I was so harsh to you. Please forgive me. See, that is what we do at the altar. We ask for forgiveness and one another, and we bring reconciliation. You see, and so that is what needs to happen. Is that we are living sacrifice. We press in to the blood and the fire. And so God told Mary, Mary Kay Baxter, you have to do warfare. You have to go to churches and start a war. That the altar comes back in the church. Why? So conviction will come. Conviction of what? Of sin. Because when the fire is in the house of God, conviction is in the house of God. See, what is the big battle right now? Why are not many getting saved? Because there's no conviction. Why? Because the preachers don't want to talk about bad things in the church. They don't want to talk about sin. It has to be all nice. It has to be all nice. But that is unbiblical. It's very unbiblical. And so we have to preach what? About what Jesus said. He said when the Holy Spirit comes, so when the altar is there, when the fire of God is in the house of God, Jesus said, the Holy Spirit shall do what? He shall convict of sin, righteousness, and judgment. And so if we are a preacher of the gospel, yeah, we have to talk about sin, righteousness, and judgment. We should not be afraid of it. Why? Because Jesus said so. And so the fire was on Apostle Peter. And what happened? What happened, Jill? They were convicted.
Yes.
And they said, men, brothers, what must we do? Because they were cut to the heart by the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. They were convicted. And they cried, what must we do? And Apostle Peter said, repent and be baptized. And 3,000 were saved. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Can you say amen?
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.